Good afternoon, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be with you today in New Zealand, even from the distance. So it's, I'd like to start really by acknowledging my co-author, Stuart Kemp from Pastor Wise, Cameron Clark and Rafi Gisland from here at the University of Sydney, and Oboru Ota and Darren Criticos from CSIRO. So if we go to the next slide, the climate is already changing. We know that. Brendan really presented that very well. I guess the question is, there's an increasing interest in the question of what will the typical dairy regions in New Zealand look like in the future? And what can we learn from the climates that may have experienced similar things that New Zealand regions are likely to experience in the future? So what we did is, and there's a lot of the more details in the paper, what we did in the next slide was to use Climex compare locations. If we can go to the next slide, please. We use Climex compare locations, which calculates an eco-climatic index that goes from 0 to 100. And in all the slides I'm going to show quickly now, the more red, the better. This eco-climatic index basically calculates, it's the product of two indexes, a growth index and a stress index. And the stress index basically calculates if a particular climate is too wet, too dry, too cold, or too hot for a particular species. In this case, we're concentrating on dairy cattle. So you can see, I guess, at a glance, looking at the colors, that for New Zealand compared to 2020 on the left with 2050 on the right, there's practically the same level of red in both slides, in both graphs. So basically indicating that the suitability for dairy based on climatic aspects only, it's quite good in 2050. The problem seems to be more for us here in Australia. You can see the amount of red, particularly on the eastern coast and the New South Wales coast in particular, is diminishing as we go into the future. Excuse me. We also use the Climex Match Climates to calculate the composite match index that goes from 0 to 1, and this basically is to compare similarities or not between different regions in terms of climate. In this first graph, I'm showing the situation for Northland. So basically, Northland highlighted there in blue, it's the climate, the projected climate for Northland in 2050 resembles to some extent that in the Sydney Basin today, and perhaps a little more on the east coast of New South Wales. But you can see that it's not a lot of red color there, and again, in all these graphs, the more red, the better match. If we go to the next one for Waikato, there is also a bit of similarities with the New South Wales coast in particular. But the biggest or the main analog for Waikato is found in Northland. So in other words, according to this modeling exercise, the challenges being faced in Northland today are likely to be faced by the Waikato in the future, according to this model. For the Manawatu, the situation is a bit different. There is a little more similarities with southeast Victoria in particular, and then northeast Tasmania in Australia. But again, the main analog for the Manawatu climates in terms of, the future 2050, can be found in the Waikato and central of the North Island in New Zealand. And finally, for Southland, more similarities with across Tasmania and Southeast Australia. But once again, the main analogs for Southlands are found in Northern Southland, Canterbury, and also southern part of the North Island in New Zealand. So in summary of all this part, there is the main analogs for the key dairy regions in New Zealand are to be found in New Zealand, with the exception of Northland. So we then ask, what can we learn from these climate analogs? And I want to, basically, there's a lot of information in the paper in terms of the review of literature, but I'm trying to summarize all that into just this is live, and this is live first shows the, I guess, the points to the key issue, which is the in terms of future climate, which is the decrease in rainfall and increase in intra and inter-annual variability, and that is represented by that broken line going through the graph. And what the graph represents is that the, as we go from past climates to future climates, the intensity of the peaks, whether it's drought or floods, will increase, as we know. And also the, will increase in intensity and also in frequency. So the other thing that this graph shows is the area between the two blue solid horizontal lines will represent really the, this zone of system control, that area basically where the farmer or the manager can be in control of the farm production, regardless of whether there is a adversity in the climate. So I guess what we're trying to represent is that the going to the future, the challenge is for individual farmers and managers to see how can they increase the zone of system control, and basically which is represented on the right-hand side of the graph by those orange or pinky areas, both above and below, so representing either extremes too much water or too little water, which is the real killer for pasture-based systems. So the question is then, and this is the basis of our discussion in the paper, how, what are the real, what is research showing that can be done in, to increase that zone of system control? And we summarize that in three main aspects. The first one is to increase the battery size, in a sense that if we cannot increase the amount of water that will obviously come from rain, from the rain, we can instead increase this, the capacity of the soil to retain more water. And basically the analogy here is to increase the size of the battery, the reservoir of water. And that can be done by two things. One is the species with larger root systems, as I mentioned before by Brendan, but which will be one of the possibilities, going, for example, Fescue pararis, coxwood, with we have deeper root system compared to ryegrass, or and also the possibility of manipulating or improving soil carbon at the individual paddock level, depending on soil type, of course, which in turn can increase or improve soil structure and improve water retention in the soil. The second one is adaptive management strategies, and that is mainly, we focus mainly on the revision of double and triple cropping. There's a lot of research done in the last two decades in Australia, particularly in terms of double and triple cropping. And the key thing coming out of that is really water use efficiency. The ability of those cropping systems to increase water use efficiency 4, 5, 6 times compared to that of perennial ryegrass. That is extremely important. Again, if we emphasize that the key real issue to worry about going to the future is soil moisture, in a few words. And the last one is to the opportunity to be strategically opportunistic in the planning. And what we mean by that is that the basically how, what we can do in terms of farming planning at the individual farm level to increase the flexibility and be less exposed to the adversity coming from the climate. In other words, if we are 100% based on perennial ryegrass, I'm talking about dairy system here, and we have a drought, obviously the flexibility is absolutely minimum or none. However, if we have the possibility to somehow plan to have a 20% of the farm, or whatever it is required, with a increased water retention because of the management previously done to the paddock, and being able to rapidly be converted into a summer crop or something like that, the ability to capture the opportunity when the rain comes, for example, is much, much higher than in a pure, wholly pasture-based system. That's only one example that I wanted to show. There is a lot more discussion in the paper. So in conclusion, the key challenge, as I said, is the reduction in total rainfall and increase in intra and inter-season variability. Again, obviously, increasing temperature is a worry, as we all know, but it's a lot more predictable. The real issue from a production point of system point of view is in reduction of rainfall and increasing variability. As we saw, the analog climates for New Zealand, the region can mostly be found in New Zealand, with the exception of Norland. And the adaptive management strategies, particularly how we increase the zone of system control, is the key for really looking into this adversity going into the future. Thank you very much for the opportunity.